Hello, everyone, and welcome to the last session of the third annual Climate Symposium. My name is Lindsay Lunau, and I'm an Environmental Outreach Coordinator with the City's Environmental Management Program supporting the Climate Program. I am excited that this is our last session for the Climate Symposium. We're thrilled that we've been able to offer 25 total sessions over the last 2 days. And just a reminder that if you're joining us for this first session, all of the previous ones have been recorded and will be posted to calgary.ca/climatesymposium in the coming weeks. So just before we get started, I would just like to take this opportunity to acknowledge that we are broadcasting from the traditional territories of the people of the Treaty 7 region in southern Alberta. Now, this includes the Blackfoot Confederacy made up of the Siksika, Piikani, and Kainai First Nations. It also includes the Itka, Nakota, Wikastabi First Nations, comprised of the Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Wesley First Nations, and Sutina First Nation. The City of Calgary is also homeland to the historic Northwest Métis and the Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3. We acknowledge all Indigenous urban Calgarians who have made Calgary their home. So for today's session and for all of our sessions, we've been using the Microsoft Teams live event platform. And like I said before, our sessions have been recorded. So as an attendee, you can access the recording of this session with your joining link for 30 days. And as I did mention before as well, the recordings will also be posted to our website in the coming weeks. In the interest of privacy protection, as members of the audience, you're not able to share your audio or video during these sessions. However, you can interact with myself and with Gregory through the Q&A. The Q&A looks like two overlapping speech bubbles with a question mark on top. Now let's just have a quick look at the agenda for today. So following a few more opening remarks from me, I'll hand it over to Gregory Caswell for the Emerald Documentary Series, a mini film festival. So there will be a chance for questions after we finish watching all the documentary shorts. However, throughout the documentaries, you're welcome to post your questions in the Q&A, and Gregory and I will be looking at that, and we can answer your questions throughout by text. We will endeavor to answer all of your questions either in the Q&A or in the post-video verbalized Q&A. And I do apologize in advance if we're not able to get to your questions, as sometimes the Q&A over the last couple of days has been very active. On that note, I would also like to recognize Rob Crystal, who also supports the City of Calgary's climate program. Rob is working behind the scenes to help this look seamless, and helping us as well in the Q&A. I do want to note that we are planning on playing some videos and we're a bit concerned about bandwidth. So I'm going to start by sharing videos from my computer first, but if we're having an issue, we will switch over to Rob's. So please bear with us as delivering a virtual event is not always super easy. Both Rob and I will be posting announcements and links to resources into the Q&A. And I think there should be one right there now where we're inviting you to join the discussion about climate change and about this event on social media using the hashtag YYC Climate Symposium. So just very quickly before handing it over to Gregory, I would like to take a moment to recognize all the partners in the community who helped to spread the word about the Climate Symposium, have offered to host sessions, or have put on satellite events throughout this week and even some leading into the weekend. Now, over to Gregory. I'd like to thank Gregory for joining us today and to contribute his expertise and be here for Q&A after these documentary shorts. So Gregory Caswell's interest in everything green started at the age of 10 when he was given a book filled with environmental experiments and explanations. For many years later, Gregory joined the Alberta Emerald Foundation as the communications and outreach manager and played a crucial role in the development of the current program offerings. In 2019, Gregory took over the helm as the executive director, and every day is now filled with excitement for the people he gets to work with and the amazing initiatives he gets to oversee. So I see that Gregory's already queued up on the screen there, and I'd just like to remind you before I turn it over to him that our presentation is a selection of documentary shorts with a chance for Q&A at the end. We do plan to wrap up by 5 p.m. with a few closing remarks from myself. And please post your questions in the Q&A throughout the presentation. So Gregory, welcome. And now I invite you to go ahead and unmute your microphone.
Well, thank you so much for having me, Lindsay. It's such a pleasure to be here to share these videos. A little bit about the Alberta Emerald Foundation before we kick it off. The Alberta Emerald Foundation is our province's environmental good news storytellers. We are the nonprofit charity that presents the Emerald Awards every year, which seems to be what people know us for the most. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the Emeralds, though, they are a unique awards program in Canada that showcase those in our province who raise the bar in addressing local, regional, and global environmental and climate issues. Through these actions, a standard of excellence is set that inspires others in their own practices. And actually, this is a pretty big day at our foundation because this morning we announced the 30th annual Emerald Awards shortlist, and I must say, Calgary is very well represented. In recent years, we realized that we have an opportunity to share the stories of our recipients to inspire others to become better environmental stewards. And so we've developed the Emerald documentary series, which we'll be sharing some of the videos today, as well as the What on Earth Can We Do podcast and the Emerald speaker series. It's very easy these days to get lost in the doom and gloom stories and forget that there are people who are committed to finding the solutions to and are mitigating the effects of climate change. I count myself very privileged to travel the province and witness firsthand the amazing and inspiring work that is happening all over Alberta. And so it's my great pleasure to be able to close off the Climate Symposium on a hopeful note by sharing some of our content in this mini film festival. The videos I've curated for this event are exceptional examples from both Calgary and surrounding areas and the rest of the province of folks who are addressing the issue of climate change in their own unique way. Enjoy.
Beaumont Park is what many people know of this particular area. We're on the Bow River Valley. And one of the things that we had known for a long time was that there was a piece of land essentially in the middle of Beaumont Park that was a gravel pit. And it had come to the end of its useful life. And we had been talking about what would the fate of that land be.
Parks was looking at how do we restore, how do we look at creating a beautiful park for citizens. At the same time, the city was also needing stormwater management. You know, with those two objectives in mind, we started looking at that collectively.
So you're in the one of the access points to the Dale Hodges Park. And at this point, you're walking down to really meet where the two underground pipes, which were previously invisible, are located. And we intersect those, and what you start to see just here, this first section on the edge of the hillside, is half of what we call a source wall. UEP had done a study of 80% of the city's built environment to look at where they could site stormwater retrofit projects. Where can they treat stormwater? And this was one of the most important sites because of the volume of stormwater that flows through two pipes. And at peak flow, they're capable of carrying 50 cubic meters of water per second. It's over 300 washing machines per second flowing through these pipes. In every rainfall, you have a massive amount of water flowing untreated directly into the Bow River. So it was a really valuable site. We're at the point where the water from those pipes becomes visible, and in different events, different holes are activated. So as the intensity of a rain event increases, more and more holes are activated. So it becomes this kind of more and more dramatic scenario where you can see how intense the storm is. It's really a kind of a barometer to the what's happening in our wider environment. That's the intention, is to say, you know that storm that happened last night? Let's see how it's impacting our watershed. And you could come down here as a small child and be like, whoa, look at that, that's insane.
The stormwater system that's been put in place is critical because what it does is it gathers all of the rainwater or snow melt from the communities up on the escarpment, and it captures it, it slows it down, and it takes the sediment and pollutants out, and then through a series of ponds and wetlands, the water is cleaned, filtered, and it goes back into the bow in a much cleaner state.
What you see behind me is the Nautilus pond. So as it comes, as the water comes down from the pipes, comes through the source walls here, it then enters into the Nautilus pond in a pipe that goes underneath here. And what's happening is the water is going round in a circle. So that whole idea of slowing it down, spreading it out, allows the total suspended solids and anything that's in that water, rubbish, garbage, those things that come off our streets, to be either suspended if it's light or to drop to the bottom if it's heavy. And we can then introduce it into the rest of the treatment train.
Bringing artists in at the onset, at the inception, I think provides that opportunity right at the beginning to really kind of set the stage for a different type of project and bring in that creative thought. And I think that sets the stage for a very unique opportunity.
As the concept, we were really interested in not simply solving a problem, but somehow elevating the possibilities of what it could be. How can the water treatment become an opportunity to, on one hand, create habitat and create an environment that itself can be a park, and on the other hand, how can that treatment be visible?
We wanted that intrigue of, well, where does that water flow? You kind of invite that question of where does it go next in this way? So it's a bit like those storybooks you had as a child where you could choose your own story. That's what we kind of wanted to do, so that when you come one time, you might follow this way, you might go that way. The whole thing might look and feel differently the next time, but you're invited to ask the question. It becomes something you're intrigued about rather than being told that didactic, here's how it goes, do this, this is what happens in water treatment. You're starting to experience it rather than being told it. Artists are trained in most fields to really interrogate and explore a question, not necessarily just to find the answer, which I think is some of the differences between design and art, is that design is often the pursuit of finding the perfect answer to something. Artists are often trying to explore the breadth and complexity. They often make things more diverse than what you might find in design. So I think when we trust artists and empower them to make work in a city, they can bring a different quality. They don't have all the answers, but they can bring a different quality to some of the other subject matter experts. So the water came down the stream on the left-hand side and has moved through several cells to the other side to form this stream. The water runs straight underneath this bridge and has moved again to the other side of the site, to this side, to then start that journey again. So it then goes through this next cell and the next cell and the next cell, all the time polishing, 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 polishing before it reaches the stream on the opposite side.
I think for me personally, it has changed my thinking about how we restore habitat in a city. I think some of the questions that Tristan and Charles asked of us in thinking through the design, some of the perspectives that they brought, were an eye-opener to me, because I know I walked into this initially thinking, I want the site restored, I want a very traditional approach, I didn't want too much more than that. But actually some of the conversations we had, I think, drew out some of those questions about how do you marry these two systems, the natural and the gray, if you will.
This is where we intersect the regional pathway. So it's an important point of people passing on both sides. It's also where the end of the Dale Hodges Park treatment train ends, that journey, that story that we've been on through the site, re-enters into the Bow River. So this is the result. This is where the clean, polished water re-enters and we've kind of done our job. And on its way, we've been able to create all these different habitats and a public park for people, which was the intention of bringing it into the site and making it visible and daylighting.
It actually blows my mind when I think about, I used to bike here years and years ago, and to see it where it is now is absolutely amazing. I've talked to so many people who are absolutely blown away by just the beauty of the infrastructure. People don't even realize that it's a functional piece of infrastructure. It's just so beautiful, and all aspects of it, and right through to the finishing wetlands and the water going into the river, it is amazing. And the wildlife, like, it's created such an amazing natural area. So it, you know, it increases our biodiversity. There's just so many benefits to it, and it is just such a beautiful, beautiful space that so many people can use.
Municipal Climate Change Action Centre is a partnership of the Alberta Urban Municipalities Association, the Rural Municipalities of Alberta, and the Government of Alberta. We are helping municipalities with their climate change activities. We deliver technical advice, education, and funding programs to help them take action on climate change. We are a resource, we are a hub, we are a service to municipalities across the province. With municipalities having a heavy influence on activities across the province, they saw opportunities to really make a difference in reducing greenhouse gas emissions.
Yeah, my name is Mark Baxter. I'm the program lead for our renewables programs here at the Municipal Climate Change Action Centre. So that includes our Alberta Municipal Solar Program, which is a funding program for municipalities to install solar PV systems on their own facilities and land, Solar for Schools program, which is the same thing for public school authorities in Alberta, and then our community generation initiatives. So we had a capacity building initiative for municipalities to undertake community generation feasibility studies, and then the Municipal Community Generation Challenge now, which is our larger flagship program for funding projects towards capital development of community generation facilities. Basically, the municipalities take on the projects for a number of different reasons, some looking just to lower their emissions, others to see the energy savings, some a combination of all of that. Municipalities are really well suited, given that they have large electricity loads, to install solar PV, see basically their electricity costs get offset from the production that they have now from their system, which means less money that needs to go towards that and more money that they can put towards their other operations. We're obviously very happy with seeing the lower emissions as well from offsetting of any other higher fossil fuel greenhouse gas emission generation from electricity. So,
my name is Calvin Leckelt. I'm a program lead for energy efficiency with the Municipal Climate Change Action Center. I essentially program manage the suite of energy efficiency programs that we offer. So the Municipal Energy Manager Program, the Recreation Energy Conservation Program, and our Electric Vehicles for Municipalities Program. We've actually incorporated an approach that could be custom relative to that municipality's capacity in this space. So if they don't know anything at all about any of the opportunities in their facility, we can help fund an energy audit or engineering study to help them work with a contractor to find out those opportunities. But if they do have some capacity, they know, well, I just want to do a lighting retrofit, I just want to do something that's fairly simple, we can bypass that audit and go straight into a project and work with them from there. It'll help save energy costs, help save maintenance costs, reduce greenhouse gas emissions, creates spaces that are more comfortable for the occupants, and it creates local jobs and can create a lot more convenience for the building operators as well. The Municipal Energy Manager Program helps municipalities hire energy managers that then work inside their communities just like a regular town employee, and they identify energy efficiency opportunities, they track energy savings, all of these kinds of things, and that's really a capacity building program that enables municipalities that don't have a lot of experience in this field to not only get off the ground running, but participate in all of our other programs as well, where in some cases they didn't have someone who knew how to apply for grants. So now their energy manager can do that for them and help them save on energy costs and save emissions.
My name is Carly Beaver. I'm the program lead for the Clean Energy Improvement Program. The Clean Energy Improvement Program is a financing program for energy efficiency and renewable energy projects that municipalities can offer to property owners in their community, both commercial and residential. Clean Energy Improvement Program offers low interest, long-term flexible financing for clean energy improvements. So property owners can access this financing to complete upgrades on their properties. And it's a really innovative type of financing because the loan is actually tied to the property and not the individual. This program is a really exciting, innovative financing program that municipalities can provide to their residents and really enable property owners to make those improvements on their homes and their properties, whereas they may not have the capital available, they may not be able to access other financing opportunities, and this is a really affordable, flexible way for municipalities to offer that option to their residents.
As the climate change advisor, my role is to work on our advisory services. So these programs kind of complement our funding programs by supporting municipalities in their climate action planning and energy management initiatives. We do this work through two programs. The first program is our Partners for Climate Protection program. This program is actually a national program run by the Federation of Canadian Municipalities. It focuses on helping municipalities work through a 5-milestone framework to help them reduce their greenhouse gas emissions. So the first step what we start with is creating a greenhouse gas inventory. What an inventory really is just a summary of what sources exist in the municipality that create emissions. From there, we can do some work to understand where there are opportunities to make a reduction, and that helps frame a goal. Yeah, so once we have a goal, that's great, but we need a kind of a roadmap of how we get there. So this is where we move on to the third step around creating an action plan. The action plan will outline initiatives, projects, just general actions that the municipality can take to get to their target. Naturally, the next step is just implementing the plan. And then while they're working on their action items, they move into monitoring how it's going and then readjusting if they have to. Our Municipal Energy Champions program. This is a program that its intent mirrors our manager's program. We want to increase capacity in municipalities, understanding that small municipalities specifically may not have the need to bring an external role in. This program provides education, technical assistance, and doing some energy management work for the municipality. So we're trying to engage with some smaller members that may not be active in the Partners for Climate Protection program or active in really any energy management work. So we're trying to engage a new audience and leave them with some skills to move forward with some of this work. The Climate Adaptation Program is a new program to the Action Center. A lot of the work we talked about today focuses on greenhouse gas mitigation. How do we reduce the amount of emissions we are putting out into the atmosphere? This new program focuses on adapting to changes because of climate change. Really, mitigation and adaptation go hand in hand when we talk about climate action. So we're very excited to be adding this program into our suite. I think it'll complement the work that we do on mitigation quite well. Municipalities at the local level are the ones that are impacted the most by climate change risks. And I think they realize that and are identifying that to address this risk, we need to start acting on both climate change mitigation, reducing our emissions, but also some work on adaptation to the risks.
Some municipalities are doing this for the greenhouse gas emission reductions, and that's their primary goal. And a lot of other municipalities are doing it for those cost savings. They can save that money and invest more money back into their community for other things. But for some municipalities, they're still so small and they're struggling to even get by right now. So we're trying to help and reach out to those municipalities because we can set them up for future success.
One of the ways of influencing adoption in energy efficiency, renewable energy, is having these projects be visible. And municipalities are a great place for projects to be visible on recreation centers, community halls, city halls. Things like that show what is possible and inspire participation in other people. There's a real strong need to transition to a low carbon future, basically to address these increases in emissions that have been happening. So the broad range of programs that we have will help people transition to electric vehicles. They will give them opportunities in residential and commercial properties to put energy efficiency solutions into those properties and contribute to really the global impact in this space.
The Cochrane Sustainability Club is the brainchild of another science teacher, myself, back in the year 2000. The science teacher and I were getting a little bit too tired of sort of the passive projects where, if you could, what would you like to try and do? We wanted to try and figure out a way that we could literally get our hands on that technology so that we could show the kids that this works, that this is something for the future. All the different phases of the Sustainable Development Project, they have to center around sustainability. We've all come to the agreement that we consume resources and we produce waste. And can we minimize or even just make this old school a bit more efficient?
We're basically a group of students who are passionate about sustainability and also want to improve the town of Cochrane or our school. So we wanted to take on something big, but weren't too sure. And then, we just kind of started bringing up ideas. And then someone mentioned a solar panel project, and we kind of all liked that idea.
We wanted them to think big. We wanted them to think about solving some real world problems here. We want them not to be afraid of how much work it's going to be.
We had installed some solar panel projects a little earlier, kind of like a solar water heating system. And that was a smaller project and it was kind of quick, but I know we looked on where we could actually do this on the school, and the gymnasium came up, and we're like, well, we can't just put a couple solar panels up there, like one or two. We got to go big or go home. So I know we just kind of drew up what we wanted to do and then saw the costs and what we could do and then tried it. You don't know until you try. First things first, we had to figure out, what do we actually have to do? What are all the steps? We had to break it down. We had to meet with engineers to see if our roof could even hold this system, as well as, what can we do to fundraise this amount of money? This is crazy. Started with presenting to small town businesses in Cochrane, just trying to get people to donate to our project, as well as applying for grants and stuff like that. Lots of us were very nervous for most of them, but we'd start off just kind of tell them, hey, we're from Cochrane High and we're taking on this big project.
There was a lot of rejection letters, lots of them. You could see it on the kids' faces, and I'm pretty sure they were thinking, what have they got themselves into? We just kind of ride the momentum.
We'd worked really hard, but we still had quite a bit to go. So then we had to come up with an adopt-a-panel project where we could actually engage individuals in our community instead of asking for large sums of money.
That just seemed to help us in a huge way, where the kids could latch onto that. That's something anybody could buy, these panels. It was like adopt a highway, and they just ran with it. And this is where we finally reached a point where we've got about $58,000. And once that happened, then we applied to MCCAC for this huge grant where they would cover 50% of our cost. And we were there. We raised $108,000. In 18 months. We installed 130 solar panels on the roof of our gymnasium.
It's a 50 kilowatt system, so it produces approximately enough energy to power 7 average Cochrane homes for a year. The 130 solar panels on the roof of the gymnasium power 8.3% of the school's total power consumption.
It's raising eyebrows. It is saving electricity on a monthly basis, and it has cut our costs on a monthly basis. I believe that since the system has been installed in July of 2019, it's like planting 800 trees. We've saved that much carbon dioxide from being emitted into the atmosphere. We are not just this club from a high school, that we have made ourselves known to the town, and they saw us not quit, and they saw us reach that goal. Right away, I think we proved that we were worthy to maybe help them out with some big projects that they want to do for this town now.
This is a huge project. When you look at it, it's always big companies that are doing massive solar projects. And I'm there's no way I could do anything like this. And then, being a part of this sustainable club, it really showed me, hey, it's a big project, but it's doable. Like, we can really do this. And that's a huge thing for me, because yeah, now I'm more willing to take on future projects and more interested too.
Turning on this bus is just like turning on a new car. Put your foot on the brake, hit the power button, and then foot off the brake, and that means we're ready to go. Well, public transit is, I mean, it's just that, it's public transit. It's moving people, and it's moving people in an efficient manner. The City of St. Albert's always prided itself on taking the first steps. So transit leadership was tasked by Mayor Council to look at EV technologies. We first acquired our first three electric buses in spring of 2017 was the first three came on board. We picked up another four in the spring of 2018. So we have a total of seven of these buses with accumulated kilometers right now to date of 580,000 kilometers.
The City of St. Albert has an environmental sustainability policy that forms the base of all of our environmental goals that we push forward. The transit system at the City of St. Albert is a key piece to the city achieving its environmental goals. By bringing on electric buses, we're able to further decrease that total emission that the city produces and help riders feel confident that the choice they're making to take transit is a green one.
As you see, there's no diesel motor in here. So what you do is you have, I could just quickly explain what's going on. You have two of the 12 volt batteries here. And just when you turn the master switch on, this is powering the bus until it goes into high voltage mode. You got electric power steering pump, electric compressor, and then you got your power systems here that can deal with the DC-DC voltages. And both left side and right side drive motors are cooled. There's a little coolant tank on each side. And pretty simple. Okay, so environmental benefits of electric buses. We have right now 51% reduction of greenhouse gas emissions by utilizing electricity in Alberta. It's produced by coal, but it's still 51% reduction as compared to burning diesel fuel and the emissions that go along with it. We do actually have the electric bus. We have two chargers at the transit station, at the transit garage, that are actually hooked up to our solar panels. And the solar panels also, they benefit because it's green power. It comes in and it goes to the chargers, and it's a plus. It's a big benefit. Charger 4 and 5 are powered by the solar panels. So as we say here, charge buses anytime. This is our baby right here.
Well, I think overall, the City of St. Albert has a big appreciation for the work the corporation does to help them achieve their green goals. I think green goals in the City of St. Albert are looking at their footprints, so looking at where their energy is coming from. A big push to get the solar array on the transit building was, okay, we've got these electric buses, but we're pulling from coal power. What can we do to make it better, right? So that was a huge consideration, and a lot of the community got behind using that grant funding to build the solar array and have it be in action.
We have, like I say, four sections of the roof, 753 LG400 panels, and it's a solar edge system with the inverters, and they produce 285 megawatts of power annually. Our transit garage consumes approximately 700,000 kilowatts now. And out of that 700,000 kilowatts, some of that, of course, is electric bus. In 2019, we charged 186,000 kilowatts out of the building. So what we're looking at is seven power inverters. It's taking these cables from above. These come from the solar panels, and they come down into the inverters, the two, and then the one comes out. So these inverters change the power from DC voltage from the panels to AC, and then the cables go into the building via breaker box and a disconnect box, and it goes into main distribution panel. The green energy and the sun's energy supplying those kilowatts, the electric buses and also going to the rest of the building. So if our electric buses aren't hooked up and charging, that solar energy is coming into the building and is going to everything from LED lights to heaters to compressors to you name it. And it's really exciting. We don't treat an electric bus any different than a diesel bus. So it's under the same maintenance program, preventative maintenance, and then we do scheduled, unscheduled maintenance as well. Electric bus right now is coming in at 51 cents a kilometer, and a diesel bus, a 40-foot bus, is coming in at 96 cents a kilometer. That's all in with diesel fuel or electricity and maintenance, all in. This bus in particular, these electric buses, they'll go out for 10 hours in a day, let's say, and we'll match that the next day with a diesel bus, and the electric bus will come back after the 10 hours, and it will be charged up with $25 worth of kilowatt of electricity. And the diesel bus will go on the same trip the following day with the same driver, and it will take about approximately $105 worth of diesel fuel. And of course, there's emissions associated with that. We have an 18-year life cycle of our transit buses. A diesel bus at the end of its life will burn approximately $577,000 worth of diesel fuel and produce the emissions. With electric bus, we've worked it out at the current prices, with a tiny bit of inflation, we've worked it out to be approximately $277,000 worth of electricity. So we're talking about a $300,000 savings, which we're excited about. There's great positive response by City of St. Albert residents for the electric buses. The local community has grasped a hold of these buses. They like the fact that they're quiet. They want to ride around in the buses. They're green, they're air conditioned in the summertime. They're heated well in the wintertime. And, you know, a lot of them get on the electric bus and they're smiling. So that's a plus.
It's a great honor to work for the city. As someone who cares about the future, I think it's really reassuring to work for a corporation that is putting the needs of the environment up there with the needs of their community. It speaks volumes to their leadership and their care.
The city of St. Albert is a green community. It's about cultivate life, a botanical arts city. We pride ourselves on that. We have the advantage of being a small group, straight from the executive leadership, the mayor and council, to the transit leadership team and the environment, because the environment was a big part of this. And we were able to, through testing and through evaluating the electric buses, we were able to make a decision based on our real-time data that these buses would benefit St. Albert, would work in St. Albert, and especially considering that we love the environment. So it worked out well.
So EcoGrowth is a relatively new company that was spun out of Executive Mat Service, and it was designed to take our gasification technology and biomass feedstock generator into a whole new direction. So gasification is a process where we smolder wood-like materials and we burn the smoldering gases that come off. It's a very clean way to combust a woody-like material. Food waste in landfill is one of the most potent sources of greenhouse gas emission. So it's easy to start there and mandate a diversion from landfill. And so that's where we came in. We took it one step forward and say, okay, if you're not gonna landfill it, what are you gonna do? So we went straight to the biomass energy. So biomass fuel is another form of thermal energy. Whatever you're using to heat water, we actually replace that with biomass. So the food dehydration is simply a wet food in. Whatever goes in is 100%. Typically 20% comes out as a usable wood-like biomass. The rest of it was water, which has been dehydrated away.
This is like a fire log. And this is almost, you know, this is pretty close to a pound. And for each pound that we divert from a landfill, we get about 8.5 times that as a carbon offset. So if we're consuming a ton of material in these boilers, we offset 8.5 tons of CO2 equivalent. Because it didn't go to landfill, turned to methane, and it didn't use the carbon profile from a fossil fuel. use a carbon neutral fuel source. People are going to have to realize that they can keep paying the carbon tax and the fossil fuel, or they can look alternatively, probably to a waste source that's sitting right in their dumpster currently.
We're always looking to reduce our costs and reduce our carbon footprint. And once we figured it out for ourselves, then we open it up to our clients or prospective clients. So as we built our gasification plant, we refer to this as feed the beast. So what other things can we introduce to the gasification plant to obviously create hot water for the plant? Then we looked at, well, what things can we do to, with our customers while we're there doing our other services? So we looked at providing paper towel, paper cups, materials that are compatible with our boiler system. And so what we rationalized is if we could take a waste stream out of our customer's dumpster, we could reduce the frequency of their tippage, save them money, and then obviously bring it back to the plant and save ourselves money. So the ConocoPhillips project really started from their desire to reduce the amount of waste leaving their facility. So it was a waste reduction and a waste diversion project. So they've installed three of our 1,000 pound per day dehydrators. And so by dehydrating their food waste on site, they were able to reduce the frequency of trucking literally by 80% or more. The first stage was to dehydrate the organic food waste out of their kitchen. It's a 700 man camp. Phase two was to dehydrate the biosolids from their waste treatment plant and set up a system that was totally integrated with their wastewater system. And then phase three is actually to introduce our combustion and our gasification technology along with a solid shredder so that we can actually convert the vast majority of their waste into a thermal resource that they'll use to heat the water for the camp.
So the dehydrated materials, we'll load this up with 1,000 pounds of food waste or whatever wet biomass there is, and we dry it out completely, basically sterilize it using heat. The energy that is created is electrical heat on these versions. In the future versions that we make, we're going to actually be scrubbing the heat off of the boiler itself. So we'll get way more efficient with the larger systems we put into towns or communities, smaller communities.
So why is ConocoPhillips such a great partner? Well, when we first went down this road, we had not perfected the technology. And so they were willing to work with us and help us to perfect the technology, how it applies to them. They know that this is a global problem. And by solving their only problem in a 700 man camp, they know has worldwide implications and application.
I think EcoGrowth is becoming that company that is excited to explore new opportunities with the waste and just think outside the box on how to utilize them the best. It's trash to cash. It literally is trash to cash. We want people to realize that what's going into their dumpster, whatever waste it may be, 80 to 90% of what goes in any dumpster is a refuse-derived biomass fuel source. And we just want to get people to realize that.
We know as we get our technology to the point where it is today, the market is huge. And it's going to benefit everybody because we're collectively going to reduce the world's global footprint.
So very inspiring. I just feel like I want to give them all a virtual round of applause. And a big thank you to all of our participants who allowed us to share their story through the documentaries. So in addition to the Emerald documentary series, we hold the Emerald Speaker Series, which is our version of TED Talks. We provide a stage for our Emerald Award recipients to share their award-winning work and an inspiring environmental message with an audience. Very excited, we'll be filming new talks for that series in the upcoming weeks and launching them at our virtual Emerald Speaker Series on Earth Day, April 22nd. Tickets are available on a sliding scale and are now available on our website at emeraldfoundation.ca. Also, there are many more Emerald documentary series videos to enjoy on our website. In fact, there's two seasons worth. And of course, our podcast, What on Earth Can We Do? Our content is for everyone to enjoy, so if something stands out, please share it with your friends, colleagues, and followers. The more people who witness these stories, the more we can inspire positive change. And if you really love the content, personal plug here, we are always looking for new sponsors to partner with and new donors to support us in achieving our mission. Feel free to reach out to me at gregory@emeraldfoundation.ca if you would like to learn more about these opportunities. Now, I'd love to take your questions, and I should note that although I consider myself an expert in telling the stories of our recipients, I am very much an everyday Albertan with a lot to learn from our recipients. But if you have questions about the Alberta Emerald Foundation and our programs, I am very pleased to answer them.
Okay, Gregory, well, thank you so much. There are some questions coming in, and I know that you did just recognize that you are an everyday Albertan, but there is a question that came in on the Dale Hodges Park. So someone just sharing with us that they live in Bowness and didn't realize the details behind this beautiful revitalization story. And they're just wondering if you have any insight into how long it took to design and reconstruct, and if you know if the city's got some data on the storm water quality entering the river before and after reconstruction.
Very good questions. I don't have the full information for you, unfortunately, but what I can share with you is that the transition that that park went through, where it was originally, I believe it was used for mining or something like that, and what it became, I would assume that it was many, many years. There's probably more information on our website and into the exact description of the park. And I would also say that the city probably does have some really great data. Lindsay, I would turn that back to you, but you probably know more about the resources that the city has where they might be able to find some of that data.
Yeah, absolutely. And I would encourage you to check out calgary.ca, the water department, water resources. They have really great online resources. And if you're not able to find what you're looking for, please email us at climateprogram@calgary.ca. And I'll put you in touch with one of the folks that was in the video to get some more details on that. Thanks, Gregory. Hopefully I won't put you on the spot like that again. But the next question is around, does the Alberta Emerald Foundation keep track of all the initiatives that are happening in Alberta? The good news stories are so great, and it might be nice to see some stats on how we're increasingly implementing more and more innovations annually to improve our environment. So I imagine that you get a lot of applications. So what do you do to sort of track what's happening?
Yeah, you bet. Well, our website actually does operate as a bit of a database. So if you wanted to go back and see who is a recipient of an Emerald Award, that is available on our website. If you just go to the Emerald Awards tab, it's under past award winners. What we also do is we keep stories of our recipients in that same area. So you can go and take a look at, we have at least the last 5 years that you're able to go and look at. Unfortunately, once the award winners have gone through the program, we lose track of them. And so it's hard to keep up to date with all of the work that's been going on, especially saying that we, over our 30-year history, have recognized 400 recipients and 900 finalists. But there's a listing there, and it would be, if there's any that you're interested in following up on or seeing more, I highly recommend, doing a quick Google search and seeing where they're at today.
Oh, that's great, Gregory. And Judy notes in the chat here that these videos are very inspiring. And Judy is wondering where else you show these videos beyond the Emerald Awards ceremony.
Oh yeah, you bet. So this is actually work that we do beyond the Emerald Awards. All of these videos are available on our website at emeraldfoundation.ca. There's two seasons. Once we're done the 30th annual Emerald Awards, we'll be hitting the road again to do a brand new series of or season of them. So head over to our website. They are available there. They're on YouTube, so they're easy to share. And we also have other content as well. So as I mentioned, we have our podcast where myself, the Everyday Albertan, and my dear friend Colleen Nook sit down and we have conversations with all of our recipients to find out what on earth we can do to become better environmental stewards. And of course, the Emerald Speaker Series, if you love that TED Talk style, we have some great videos from last year, and we're about to do some brand new ones here and launching on April 22nd in honor of Earth Day.
Oh, that's so great. And the city is such a proud partner with the Alberta Emerald Foundation to get these good news stories out. I know it's a great resource, especially for teachers in classrooms to be able to share with kids as well. So it looks like our last questions come in from Dawn. Dawn's wondering about the Alberta Emerald Foundation itself. Are you focused specifically in Alberta? Do you have sister organizations Canada-wide or worldwide?
That's a wonderful question. We are just Alberta at this point. I mean, in my executive director dreams, I think 10 years, maybe we go national. But right now, the mandate for the foundation is that the work that we recognize either has to be initiated in Alberta or benefit Albertans.
Okay, excellent. And then I just got a clarifying question from Alex about keeping track of things. So the clarifying question is, do you keep track of climate? So I'm assuming greenhouse gas reductions or other environmental benefits in a database of some sort?
Good question, Alex. Unfortunately, we don't. But that is definitely something that maybe we should start looking at. There's quite a bit of a history behind us, so it would be quite an undertaking. But right now, our focus is more on sharing the stories.
Okay, wonderful. Well, I really found all of the documentary shorts that you chose for this mini film festival, I guess, to be really, really lovely. I was wiping tears away, actually, in the middle there. So, Gregory, thank you so much for joining us. If you wouldn't mind, Gregory, just keeping an eye on the Q&A in case some new questions come in. Sure. But I'm not seeing any right now, so I think I'd like to go ahead and just finish off with a couple of closing remarks. So first, Gregory, thank you so much for coming and sharing these videos with us and spending time with us and closing out the Climate Symposium today. I really value our partnership and really look forward to working with you to bring more of these stories forward in the future. So thank you so much for joining us today. And I really do want to, I think, welcome. Gregory, you also had a couple of closing words. So maybe you wanted to jump in there.
Well, I would just like to reiterate that back to you, Lindsay. Thank you so much for having us close out the symposium, and to all that joined us here today for the mini film festival. Like I said, these ones just scratch the surface. So if you're wanting more inspiring stories, make sure to check them out on our website. And yes, thank you for the thoughtful questions as well. Everyone have a lovely weekend.
Yep, and I'll just finish off really quickly. If I could get you to throw our last two slides up there. I do want to again thank everyone for attending this closing out session for the third annual Calgary Climate Symposium. It has been a very busy 2 days, and all of our sessions have been recorded, and we will be popping those videos up in the coming weeks onto calgary.ca/climatesymposium. We also have lots of resources if you're just looking for what you can do in your own lives to help limit climate change or to prepare for the effects of a changing climate. So feel free to visit calgary.ca/climateaction for more information. And finally, we'll be sending out a short survey. There's a link to it also in the chat, I think, if Rob's going to post it. And we would really appreciate your feedback on this session, or if you've attended other sessions, please let us know how you liked the event, what you think of the format. It's difficult switching over to produce things in a virtual environment, and we hope to see you online or in person at the next annual Climate Symposium. Thank you again for joining us today, and have a wonderful, wonderful weekend.